There you go. So it seems that it is 6:30, because if it's 6:30, we're beginning with our third evening of Ushpizin, this time with a guest, the spectacular guest, Eliezer Ben Yehuda, born in 1858 in Belarus, Russia. And credited with the revival of the modern Hebrew language. For those of you that have no understanding of what this immense task means, Eliezer Ben Yehuda almost single-handedly, Penina reminded me that he didn't do it all entirely on his own, but that he was able to gather enormous energy to bring a modern Hebrew language into our era at a time when Jews in the state of Israel were speaking Yiddish and Ladino and Romanian and Russian and whatever you like, French, Arabic. He put it all together and made sure that unified us for good or bad into this marvelous language called Ivrit. And who is better than Penina Motro, born and raised in Israel, so that served in the Israeli Navy Music Ensemble Group and graduated from Tel Aviv University. And Penina completed her master's degree in mass communication in California and worked as a video editor. You'll see that very soon, completing hundreds of Paramount Studios TV series episodes for syndication. She's actually currently a freelance video editor residing in Virginia. And what she does not tell you is that she's one of the exemplar singers of Kolot and a dear friend. Exactly, all the Kolot buddies are here. And Nina is going to be celebrating Eliezer Ben Yehuda with us. And so, without further ado, Nina, it's all yours.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for inviting me, Ramon. And I'm just going to say a few things and then we'll move on to my presentation. So I was growing up in Israel, and speaking Hebrew for me was completely natural, because my father was born in Israel as well. And he was fluent in Hebrew, so that's what I grew up on. But many kids around me in school, playing out in the parks, came from homes where parents did not speak Hebrew. Many parents immigrated from many, many different countries, and they kept their home language at home. Parents could not come to school and have parent-teacher conferences because they didn't speak Hebrew. And that was quite embarrassing for the kids. The kids my age saw Israel as Hebrew as this is our language. And they didn't look very nicely upon other languages being used, especially not in the schools. But one of the parents that came to Israel from another country was Eliezer Ben Yehuda. His native language was Russian, although he also spoke French and German. But after immigrating to Israel, well, he had a basic knowledge of Hebrew, but that was not his language. After immigrating to Israel, he was really the driving force in creating the new modern Hebrew. This Hebrew became the official language of Israel. He was a linguistic prophet, so to speak. And he is, was, and still is a very important historic figure in Israel. There is a Ben Yehuda Street in every city in Israel, every little town. Oh, yeah, that's on Ben Yehuda Street. I actually prepared a more detailed presentation. I collected information from Wikipedia and many short documentary films available about him on YouTube. I wanted to add photos to the presentation. So I figured if I do everything together and upload it to YouTube, it's going to be easier and more fluent if Ramon will just share it with us. I want to thank Ramon for his enthusiasm and creativity. And Ramon is always inspiring, but this energy during the pandemic is just amazing. So thank you, Ramon. And if you can, please share the YouTube presentation with us.
Besimcha.
Toda raba.
So here is Penina's presentation. There you go. I'm gonna make it big.
Yeah. This evening, I will present Eliezer Ben Yehuda to our virtual sukkah guests. Eliezer Ben Yehuda was born Eliezer Yitzhak Perlman, no relations to the violinist, in 1858 in Belarus, Russia. Ben Yehuda is credited with the revival of modern Hebrew language, which was established as Israel's official language. He was a lexicographer and a newspaper editor. As a child, Eliezer attended a Jewish elementary school, a cheder, where he studied Hebrew and Bible from the age of 3, as was customary among Jews of Eastern Europe. By the age of 12, he had read large portions of the Torah, Mishnah, and Talmud. His mother and uncle hoped he would become a rabbi, and they sent him to a yeshiva. There, he was exposed to the Jewish Enlightenment, Haskalah, meaning wisdom. The Jewish Enlightenment promoted liberalism, freedom of thought, among many other philosophies, including the revival of Hebrew for secular purposes. Reading the Hebrew language newspaper, Hashachar, he became acquainted with the early movement of Zionism and concluded that the revival of the Hebrew language in the land of Israel could unite all Jews worldwide. It was in Paris in 1877 that he met a Jew from Jerusalem who spoke Hebrew with him. It was this conversation, they say, that convinced him that the revival of Hebrew as a language of the new Jewish nation was feasible. In 1881, Ben Yehuda immigrated to Palestine, then ruled by the Ottoman Empire, and settled in Jerusalem. He found a job teaching at the Alliance Israelite Universelle. Motivated by the surrounding ideals of renovation and rejection of the diaspora lifestyle, Ben Yehuda set out to develop a new language that could replace Yiddish and other regional dialects as a means of everyday communication between Jews who moved to Israel from various regions of the world. Ben Yehuda regarded Hebrew and Zionism as symbiotic. The Hebrew language can live only if we revive the nation and return it to the fatherland, he said. Ben Yehuda was married twice to 2 sisters. His first wife, Dvorah, died in 1891 of tuberculosis. She left him with 5 small children. Her final wish was that Eliezer marry her younger sister, Paula Bella. And soon after his wife Dvorah's death, 3 of his children died of diphtheria within a period of 10 days. 6 months later, he married Paula, who took the Hebrew name Chemda. Chemda Ben Yehuda became an accomplished journalist and author in her own right, ensuring the completion of the Hebrew dictionary that Eliezer started but did not complete. Ben Yehuda raised his son, Ben Sion Ben Yehuda, the first name meaning son of Zion, entirely in Hebrew. He did not allow his son to be exposed to other languages during childhood. He even berated his wife for singing a Russian lullaby to the baby. Kids around that time would speak Yiddish or Polish or Arabic, but not Ben Sion. He became the first native speaker of modern Hebrew as a mother tongue. Ben Sion later changed his name to Itamar Ben Avi. Avi are the initials in Hebrew of Eliezer Ben Yehuda. The first name Itamar means island of dates, date of palm tree, which is a symbol of Zionism. Itamar will be referred to in the song I will present at the end of this talk. Ben Yehuda was a major figure in establishment of the Committee of the Hebrew Language, Va'ad HaLashon, later the Academy of the Hebrew Language, an organization that still exists today. He was the author of the first modern Hebrew dictionary and became known as the reviver, HaMechaye, of the Hebrew language, despite opposition to some of the words that he coined. The biblical Hebrew did not include many words that we use today in the modern era. Words like innovation or ice cream or cauliflower, these are not in the Bible. So to accomplish the task of building a comprehensive language, Ben Yehuda and the committee decided that in order to supplement the deficiencies of the Hebrew language in the Bible, the committee will create new words based on rules of grammar and linguistics from the Semitic roots, Aramaic and especially Arabic roots. Ben Yehuda faced fierce opposition from Jerusalem's ultra-Orthodox community. They objected strongly to the use of Hebrew, the Bible language, the holy language, for day-to-day esoteric conversations. Modern Hebrew was established nonetheless. Ben Yehuda built a house for his family in the Talpiot neighborhood of Jerusalem, but died 3 months before it was completed. His wife, Chemda, lived there for close to 30 years. 10 years after her death, her son transferred the title of the house to the Jerusalem municipality for the purpose of creating a museum and study center. The house is now a conference center and guest house run by a German organization, Action Reconciliation Services for Peace, or ARSP, which organizes workshops, seminars, and Hebrew language Ulpan programs. In December of 1922, Ben Yehuda, aged 64, passed away from tuberculosis. He was buried on the Mount of Olives Cemetery in Jerusalem. His funeral was attended by 30,000 people. A song was written in honor of him named Eliezer Ben Yehuda and became very popular in the 70s. Lyrics by Yaron London and music by Mati Kaspi. In this YouTube video, it is performed by Mati Kaspi together with Chava Alberstein. I translated the Hebrew and provided the subtitles. Hope you enjoy it.
כמו הנביאים הקנאים לשם, הוא פינה לפועל ולתואר ולשם, ובחצות הששית בחלונות, היה רושם במילונות אילי תילים, מילים יפות, מילים אפות, מתגלגלות מן הלשון. אליעזר, מתי תשכב לישון אין קומתך כמעט אפיים שחר והעברית אשר חיכתה אלפיים היא תמתין לך עד בוא השחר
אליעזר בן יהודה יהודי מבדיה מילים 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 מילים
Yeah.
Yamama ha'ivrit alpaim Nu azma havaneirena Venamci et ha'yozma Et ha'maghetz et ha'pzatza et ha'riut Likzeno tza bichtav rahut Katav kruvit, katav glida Katav et kol milon ben Yehuda
ועוד הוסיף מילים לברור ונוצתו המהירה לא נחה והשפה גדלה ולא הכירה את מראה דמותה את מראה דמותה בבוא השחר
אליעזר בן יהודה יהודי מבדע מילים 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 מילים
ובן נולד לו וחזות האיש אמר זה הבחור אקרא לו בן יהודה איתמר שמיינקות ועד גמילה מיום בואו בברית מילה ועד מותו קרוטה לו ברית עם העברית ומלחמה לא את הלעז להחריץ
איתמר אכן היה לגבר קומת אמר בפי צורה וצבר והלשון בפיו הייתה ספטבר איתמר בן אבי שאבי היה נביא
גבר כלבבי
אליעזר
בן יהודה, יהודי מבדע מילים מילים, מילים מילים הוא בדע ממוחו הקודע אליעזר, בן יהודה, יהודי מבדע מילים מילים
Get a new metal roof installed for $89. We're offering huge savings on metal roof installation to help our crews.
Mankara!
Somebody's selling something on YouTube.
Okay. No, we don't want it. All right. That was something.
Eliezer would have had a kick out of it.
I think so. I wanted to say just I couldn't resist to think that the recording that you chose for Eliezer Ben Yehuda has Chava Alberstein, a woman that was born in Poland and who's now very well known for singing Yiddish songs, that Mati Kaspi from a kibbutz of Romanian parents, I think the Parbarim are there too, right?
The Dudaim,
right. And I think one of them is actually from Iraq, I believe.
Yes.
So a phenomenal group of people all coming to pay homage to Eliezer Ben Yehuda. And on top of that, of course, Mati Kaspi, who wrote the music, and had a very strong influence of Brazilian music. You can hear that as well. So very, very, very profound. Penina, it's impressive that that you bring all this to us. And I think for those of us that have grown up learning Ivrit, Hebrew, and realizing that this language was the law of the land for so many years, to imagine what it would have been at the 1930s or so, when there was such a melange, a mishmash of different roots and traditions. I wonder how that was reflected, and I wonder if, other than what you mentioned about the ultra-Orthodox community, if people actually felt resistance to this. Do you?
I don't think so. As I said, the kids who spoke Hebrew felt very cool. We are cool. We don't speak Polish. We don't speak Romanian. We don't speak Ladino. We are one new country with a new language. So the answer is no. We loved it. It's actually funny that when we kids played outside and we speak Hebrew with each other, a mother would go on the balcony and want to call her son or daughter to come home, and they would shout out from the balcony in Polish. And so all the kids would know how to say, "Hey, come home," in Polish, or somebody else will shout in another language. So we picked up little sentences in other languages, but we felt like Hebrew was our language.
Wow, right. Interesting. Nan Wellens is saying something that I didn't know at all. She says that the Technion, right, in Haifa, the famous institute of technology and engineering, was very resistant. She says they wanted to teach in German.
Can I just add something? When I arrived in Israel in 1979, I was given an introduction to a lovely Yekki couple, German immigrants who had come in the 30s, and they lived in Haifa, of course, and they had not bothered to learn Hebrew, and none of their friends had either. They went every day to the makolet, to the little corner grocery, and bought their Jerusalem Post in English. They said they had zero desire to learn how to speak Hebrew, only German and English.
Wow. And then Robin Tabak is saying something amazing. She says that she taught Sam and Ara Ben Yehuda at the synagogue Bet El.
I also taught their older sister, Laila, was in my class 3 years earlier. Sam and Ada are currently in the fifth grade, and their dad is Gadi Ben Yehuda, and mom is Jenna Ben Yehuda, and he's their great. They never knew how many greats, so if they don't know, I don't know. But they are direct descendants of the Ben Yehuda family. And the thing that's even funnier about it is this is our textbook. It's Ot Libaot is letter by letter. And this is teaches starting with, you know, a shin and goes on letter by letter. And the entire book has stories about Eliezer Ben Yehuda and how he introduced different words and how he chose what he was thinking when he made up, it's a riot, made up different words. And the character who tells all these stories is Dolk. So that's who you see. You see my hair on the cover. But it's really, it's great. And we were told they had some disparity, those twins, about some portion of the story, about what happened with the dog when the dog was injured. But it's really about how he insisted on Hebrew words, and he insisted that his wife, Devorah, only speak in Hebrew, or he wouldn't answer her unless she did. And talks about she goes to the store and she wants noodles, and she doesn't have a word for noodles, and she actually makes up that particular word. But it's really interesting to see what he does and how he puts words together and then how he expands them using different roots.
Another thing that seems quite remarkable, I mean, the song was mentioning all these words seem kind of like so funny, like ice cream, like glida, right? Mm-hmm. And then other words are particularly interesting, like for instance, electricity. Like you have chashmal, and I think mm-hmm. it comes all the way from the prophet Zechariah, I believe, or I think it's something that they actually translated in some way that reminded us of electricity. And other words, like when I guess they didn't know what to do, like information was informatia at some point, and then became some more sophisticated into Meida. But I think there was this very interesting way of how to incorporate what you were saying, Penina, about incorporating words that they needed to use, right? Styles. I don't know. It's fantastic, right?
It's a fascinating job. Yes, that they did. Most as I mentioned, they try to keep all the new words that they invented coming from the Semitic languages like Aramaic and Arabic. So they, some of the words that existed from there, they adapted it to Hebrew. But words like ice cream, they went to Italian and it's gelato. So gelato and glida has some kind of the same sound, or sugar, they made it sukkah. Huh. They took words from other languages and just adopted it. Some of the words that he invented were never accepted. For instance, telephone. He came up with the word for telephone, but it never caught up. They just used the I guess it's the English or Latin. They took some of the words did not make it, but the majority of them did.
So I have a question for you that I'm sure many of our people here might be interested in. First of all, I can't refrain from saying that, for instance, potatoes come from French, right? Like tapuach adama, pomme de terre. So, but I wanted to ask you about accentuation, because there is this old thing, and in the States especially, you hear a lot of people of talking about Ashkenazi and Sephardic accentuation, and how Israeli Hebrew took into what is called Sephardi accentuation. And I always say, it seems to me that it takes the accentuation of the Tanakh, of the Bible, when you have the accentuations there. And I wonder if he thought about that at all.
I'm not sure about that, but as you probably know, there are two accents, or two ways to pronounce it, Hebrew, which is the mil'el and the mil'ra. We use the mil'el because it's how we decided to speak the Hebrew in that sort of style. But mil'ra is more the way that Eastern European Jews pronounce words, which is not the same way.
I know we're almost out of time, but I think Karen had her hand up, and I know Fran would like to say something real quick. So Karen, can you unmute and let's have your question?
Well, actually, my question was answered in the chat. I just wondered, what is there an organization that decides on new words? And, you know, when you say they accepted, who's they? But I think there's an Academy of Hebrew Language, mm-hmm. Nan says. So is that your understanding, Penina?
Actually, that's a great question. And as soon as we're done, I'm going to look into it, because I don't think they invent new words anymore, but I may be wrong. It's a really good question.
There are new words in English too, you know, that make it into the dictionary or don't make it into the dictionary. So that's why I asked.
They have a wonderful Facebook page. You might want to check it out.
Well, actually, and I know the army is very
and Fran, I think, has a short.
Yeah, it's David. I don't know if this is true or not, but many years ago, I was told that the part of the car that holds the tires together, it has a new word, and so therefore each car has a front back axle and a rear back axle.
Back axle.
Yeah, it is unfortunate that these days I see it in the Israeli newspapers, I see it sometimes on their uploads to YouTube, that English is getting into the language so much. They use so many English words where they're perfectly good Hebrews, Hebrew exists. But the fascination with Israelis with English is such that makes a lot of the Hebrew words being forgotten. They use, they say campaign. Why do you use the word campaign? I have many other explanations, but there's a great author, Meir Shalev, who came here and spoke many times. And I actually, at the end of his talk, I raised my hand and I complained about that. So he said he'll do something about it.
So
I'd like to ask you about, do we have a moment? You know, when feminism came into being and actually made it inroads into Israel, the Academia LaLashon had to come up with a word for gender, because in Hebrew, mean is both gender and sex. But they had to come up with a specific word for gender so people can get across the idea that there are two ideas here. So they came up with the word migdal. So now you have min and you have migdal for gender.
I wonder if it's being used.
So that's fascinating. But I'm
when you put
with the time. So I would love Rabbi Gila to tell us about what we're going to be tasting tomorrow night.
I want to say thank you so much to Penina. This was wonderful and such a fascinating historical figure whose work, life's work lives on. It's really extraordinary. Tomorrow night we have reserved for Jewish physicists. And specifically, we're going to be introduced to Dr. Lise Meitner, the second woman in the world to receive a doctorate in physics in, want to guess what year? I'm going to tell you, 1905. And welcoming Dr. Meitner will be Dr. Shalom Flank, a well-known teacher in Jewish circles in Washington, D.C., and a dear friend, and a microgrid architect with urban ingenuity. So I'm really looking forward to that. And on Thursday night, Karen Lantner will be our presenter on Jewish artists. So we have two more nights of just delightful conversation, and I hope you'll join us. And we wish you a moadim l'simcha, a enjoyment of this holiday that stretches this beautiful week. So Laila Tov, everybody. Thank you, Ramon.
Laila Tov, Rabbi Gila. Thank you, Penina. Thank you so much, everybody.
And thank you for the suggestions in the chat. Beautiful.
Yes, there are amazing explanations in the chat. We all should take advantage of. For those of you that have missed the other sessions, please know that we have them all recorded as well as Penina's. So don't hesitate to go and check them out. Laila Tov.
Laila Tov.